pursuing this question of what is gravity further, we have to also define what is the creation or the dissolution of matter. Because we're dealing with matter at its most fundamental level, and so we have to be able to define both if we define in either one of them. So gravity is a phenomenon that all matter can exhibit. It's just that the X and Y pre-hydrogen atomic elements of Dmitri Mendeleev's more advanced periodic chart that we have not come to know, unfortunately, those X and Y pre-hydrogen elements are specialists in the features that they exhibit. But of course, even greater than them is the ether itself. Now, I described something in that post I made to Mark Boulanger's Tanked Water, that water falling behaves like a liquid, but when it's lifted back up again, it behaves like a solid. And because it's subdividable when it falls, something which does not happen when it's being lifted, you never lose the overall pressure when it becomes subdivided, and you increase the quantity of speeds because you get all these individuation of the molecules of water that are falling that are acting independent of each other when they fall. So you can put as many generators in line as you like to catch their fall and catch the energy. And the generators are based on speed, not based on pressure. They need speed to exhibit amperage, to express their potential energy of spin, the spin of the turbine of the generator in the form of amperage, and what the spin of the turbine's effect has upon the coils within the generator, the electric coils. So, but the torque, the pressure, is fully exhibited when the water is being lifted on the opposite line, the line that's allowing for the transportation of the water back up to the tank from the bottom of the hill back up to the top of the hill. Now, when we look at gravity, we're looking at something similar on a smaller and a more efficient scale. So objects exhibit gravity, all objects exhibit gravity, or else they wouldn't have an interaction with the core of the planet, which specializes in gravity. So there is a gravitational pull between objects, but it's usually neutralized, and that's the problem. Because matter, from hydrogen on upwards, exhibits both an electric field and a magnetic field. And this is, of course, most pronounced in metal conductors, electrical conductors, such as metal. But, and then we can mimic in a small way what the X and Y pre-hydrogen atomic elements exhibit in a much more grander fashion by using metal, probably because metal exhibits a coherence of the electric and magnetic field, or a potential for coherence that we can then manipulate to create that semblance of semblance of specialization through coherence, so that we can mimic the action of the existence of the X and Y pre-hydrogen elements and suggest their existence. This is what electronics does for us. So the X and Y atomic elements are so lightweight, they give up their ambiguity as to what they exhibit, either the electric field or the magnetic field, and instead become very pronounced in exhibiting only one, or predominantly one over the other, predominantly the electric field over the magnetic, or vice versa. And that is because they give up their ambiguity when they reduce their mass down to the level which X and Y is, very lightweight. Now, they chase each other's tail, yet they still exhibit the right angles with respect to each other, just as matter exhibits an electric or magnetic field at right angles to each other, particularly metallic matter. But they do the same thing, so in a sense, well, they're not attracted to each other. They're actually repelled from each other, or else they wouldn't exhibit a 90-degree spin angular difference between them, regardless of whether they're specialized X and Y, or whether they're the combined ambiguous effect of matter from hydrogen on upwards, exhibiting both fields. So it shows the 90-degree difference in their spin orientation shows that they are actually repelled from each other. So how can they congregate at the center of a spheroidal stellar body such as a planet or a star? It is because they're not attracted to each other, they're attracted to the void left behind each other. They're still the ether. They are not the ether. They are the portal through which we gain the benefit of the ether, the infinitude that the ether can bequeath to us. And that is the so-called infinite creation of matter and or energy, and its infinite dissolution for that matter. They are the portal through which that occurs, but I'm getting ahead of myself. So what the X and Y pre-hydrogen elements do is they want to go to the ether. They love the ether. They love the ether better than anything, or else they wouldn't have lost all their mass to get down to that state if they did not love the ether so much. So they're not attracted to each other. They're attracted to the ether, but a very specific condition of the ether that would cause them to congregate into a ball, a swirling mass of a ball, in which they chase each other's tail. Now, what does that mean, to chase each other's tail? The yang-yin symbol gives us these clues. They chase each other's tail because they chase the void left behind the other. So let's take the example of the X. The X chases the void left behind the tail of the Y. So they're not chasing the Y. The X does not chase the Y itself. It chases the void left behind the Y as the Y moves out of a particular location in space. Now, why is that? Because each one leaves a distinct impression in the ether, like a footprint. And that footprint does not become evident unless that element leaves that area, and then it's evident. When we stand on wet sand, we're not aware of, or somebody else is not aware of the footprint. We are, because we're standing in the wet sand. But somebody else is not. So we take our foot out of the sand, and then somebody else can see, oh, look, there's a footprint left behind as you step out of the sand. Now, wet sand is going to lose its footprint. So, and before it does, the other of the two elements wants to rush in there and fill the void left behind. In fact, it kind of begs the question whether or not the void is the other element. Ah, there's the rub. But the ether, like wet sand, wants to lose that impression. And that causes the continuous swirling. So the ether is rebounding back to its non-footprint state of just being smooth wet sand. And that means the other element has to rush. That means the other element that's chasing the tail has to rush in and make a new impression, but of its nature. So there are two types of footprints, an X footprint or a Y footprint, just like we can have a left foot print or a right footprint. So the Y atomic element leaves a location in space, leaves behind a Y footprint, which the X wants to rush in and fill. And it does so gallantly because it's a footprint. It's an impression formed, which forms a shape or nature, which is opposite to the element that occupied that space. So obviously, the X is going to go. Is going to want to. Oh, this gets even better. The X is the footprint of the Y, and the Y is the footprint of the X. They are each other's footprint. There you go. They are each other's footprint. Yet they are attracted to the ether. Which means there's a third component here, or a fourth, third and a fourth, and that is the void left behind each other's presence vacating that space. And that's the only time they're attracted to each other. They're attracted to the void left behind each other. And no sooner than the Y leaves this space, the X fills it. It won't leave it empty for very long. Now that explains their constant swirling. It explains their congregation into a swirling mass to form a core of a planet, of a stellar body such as a star or a planet. The core of what would otherwise be a complete hollowness. What else? It explains why we have gravity to the extent that we do, because gravity is a specialization of a core of a stellar body. Yeah, we also can have gravity among matter from hydrogen and on up in atomic weight. It's just not as much. So the core makes up the difference and draws to itself all of the matter of the universe that's heavier than itself, heavier than X and Y, forming a coalescence, which is the shell of that planet, which goes into orbit around it. Now, why would it go into orbit around it? Because matter from hydrogen on upwards exhibits both X and Y properties, both electric field and magnetic field, creating a repulsion of both types of energy, of both fields. So the electric field of hydrogen is attracted to, let's say, the Y field, or the Y element, while the magnetic field of hydrogen is attracted to the X element, swirling at the center of a hollow planet. And in other words, it's both attracted and repelled from the core of a hollow planet or a hollow star. And that causes it to be a little confused. Because on the one hand, it doesn't want to go to the core, yet on the other hand, it does. And the outcome is its buoyancy floating away from the core at a specific distance based on how much X and Y is in the core, and what that element is that's heavier than X and Y, namely from hydrogen on upwards, because that'll determine how much of an X and Y field it actually has. And so, if my analogy, taking my analogy further, if the speculation goes further, that means that the hydrogen has the strongest electric field and the strongest magnetic field, and so it's going to want to be attracted to the X and Y core the greatest degree. Does that make any sense? No, it doesn't. It's actually the opposite, you would think. Because the heavier the atomic element would be, the closer it would want to buoy itself, position itself, with respect to the XY core of a stellar body. Okay, whatever. Here's some stuff I haven't completely worked out here. I think that covers, though, gravity. Now, the creation and dissolution of matter, they are at the most refined state of existence, as we know existence to be, namely the atomic elements. They're like pre-existence, because we can only suppose or infer their existence. We can't measure them. because they're lighter than hydrogen. They're beyond measurement. Yet they do exist. They have specific qualities to them, which are diametrically in opposition to each other. Yet they're on the verge of becoming ether. And ether can become them. And I think what happens is, you know, the I Ching theory section of this theory section of the I Ching says that when something becomes extreme enough, it flips or inverts, I should say, into its opposite. It's possible, I guess you could say, that X and Y are malleable, such that you could have a portion of X or a portion of Y convert or invert into its opposite, which means if this happened at, for instance, at the core of a stellar body, you'd have an imbalance. And the ether doesn't like an imbalance, and it makes up the difference by manifesting the missing opposite elements. So if X, for some reason, became extremely X in its quality of X, it would invert into Y, creating an imbalance of the two, causing the ether, prompting the ether to make up the difference by manifesting more X. And so literally you could get a materialization of energy based on an imbalance of energy at the core. As an example, though, so just using the core as an example, because it could happen outside the core, it's just more efficient for it to happen at the core than anywhere else. In other words, to happen between the interaction between X and Y as opposed to any of the other heavier elements to provoke the ether to manifest more energy. So we can mimic with our electrical dynamics the operation of X and Y at the core of a stellar body, and thus manifest or dematerialize energy or matter on a much smaller scale. But that's not to say that it doesn't happen at the core. It does happen at the core, but much more efficiently, on a much grander scale. So this inversion of, let's say, the X element into Y creates a predominance of Y over X. And the ether won't like that, and will try to make up the difference. Now you would think, okay, if it makes up the difference, okay, so what that means is, if the X becomes so imbalanced that it is pregnant with the urgency to become Y, the ether doesn't respond just yet, and that must be Planck's constant, in which the ether does not respond just yet, because the X, although pregnant with its desire to invert itself into Y, has not done so yet, and consequently the ether does not respond, does not block, does not get in the way of X's desire to turn into Y. It waits until it actually does, and then responds to the aftermath, rather than getting in the way. So if anything gets in the way, it's X itself, wanting to maintain its integrity. Now, what would drive X into such a state of imbalance that it would invert itself into Y, or a portion of it? You know, because we've got these two masses, congregate masses, swirling around at the core of a stellar body, made up of innumerable particles of X and innumerable particles of Y. They're segregated into two distinct groups of aggregate masses of X versus Y, chasing each other's tail. So what would prompt, because we have the feature of inertia in which X wants to maintain itself at all times. So X and Y can't materialize more energy. They just materialize each other. They can convert into each other. And we can do this with our electronics. We can mimic this by converting a magnetic field into an electric field and an electric field into a magnetic field. But they can do it atomically. So what would... It's the continuance of inertia that wants to maintain an element in its state. So X wants to stay X and Y wants to stay Y. So, but what if they want to maintain their integrity of identity, what would prompt them to lose it? Which is a good question. I'll have to suppose it's pressure. If they're chasing each other's tail, what if one or the other fails to move forward? Meanwhile, it's being chased by its opposite element behind its tail. In other words, they want to move into the void left behind the the leaving, the absence. There's a word for that, a verb. Can't think of it at the moment. The X vacates its space, its footprint, and leaves a void behind. But what if it fails to? Then the other element gets bunched up behind it, creating a pressure within itself. Ah. And that pressure causes that bunched up. So let's say the X fails to move to create a void behind it, and the Y wants to move into that void that the X leaves behind, but the X fails to leave the void because it fails to move. So the Y bunches up behind the X and creates a pressure within the Y to convert into X. So if they lack sufficient dynamic movement, conversion takes place, or invert, by way of inversion, conversion takes place. So instead of movement, we get conversion. So we either, so there's two types of change possible, movement and conversion. And thus, if the X fails to move, and the Y bunches up behind it and converts into X, now we've got an imbalance, and the ether makes up the difference by bringing in more Y to make up the loss of Y. Okay, so that's the creation of matter. So what's the dissolution of matter? The dissolution of matter would be a dynamic spin so well balanced has to be more than that, though. Oh, it's the speed gets so well balanced that the speed, should it increase rather than diminish, the creation of matter was based on the lack of dynamic, a lack of movement. But if there's too much movement, if we could say that there could be such a state of too much movement, then you have too much void left behind the tail without sufficient quickness of the void being filled in. What if the impression should dissipate before it gets filled? And then, like the game of musical chairs, there's no chair to sit down in, and the element left out of the picture, let's say it's Y, has nowhere to sit, has no impression of the ether to sit itself down into, seat itself into, and is left with nowhere to go but to dissolve into back into the ether. And if that should create an imbalance, wait a minute. No, it won't. It can't, because it would prevent it from dissolution if it created an imbalance, because then it would recreate it. Recreate the opposite, see? Or, yeah. No, they have to be in a perfect state of balance, and swirling about themselves so quickly that the time lag is too great, and the impression, the footprint left behind, doesn't want to stay there for very long, and so the wet sand of the ether moves. So the ether actually moves, not just X and Y. The ether, the void left behind, the impression, the footprint, is a virtual existence of its missing element that used to occupy that space. And so that virtual existence of a footprint actually is capable of movement. But if it's not filled quickly enough, it literally smooths itself out, loses the impression. And if both X and Y, if both footprints can do this at the same rate, then they both dissolve at the same rate. So the manifestation of either X or Y is singular. Yet, it follows on the heel of the conversion of the opposite. So in a sense, it looks like they're both manifesting at the same time, even though that's not the case. One is doing the conversion by inverting into its opposite, and the other materializes out of the ether to make up the difference. But when they dissolve at the same time because their balance has to be so precise as they are spinning so quickly, swirling about each other, taking up each other's position so quickly that they literally fall behind each other. They can't keep up. And because I think what would happen is they create their own coalescence. See, they're supposed to fill each other's void, but what if they fail to do so, both at the same rate of failure? It means we've now got two separate swirls, along with the two different voids, which are failing to be filled. So we don't have two halves of the yang-yin symbol anymore. We have four pieces of the yang-yin symbol. We have the white and we have the dark, the light and the dark, but we also have the impression left behind the light and the impression left behind the dark. And so now we got four elements to deal with, and quite frankly, that's... how long is that going to last? Not for very long. The ether will make up the difference by the impression in its wet sand, so to speak, nature, to raise itself, elevate itself, lose the impression, and now there's no place for the Y to go to. See, the impression left behind the prior element is a memory. And if you lose the memory, you lose the ability for X to occupy that space or for Y, depending on which one is going to fill that space. And without the memory, for all intents and purposes, the object has no place to be anymore. It only exists because of a memory, a virtual opposite to itself, or a virtual opposite to its opposite, giving it a place to exist. So the Y leaves an impression in the ether of its opposite nature, and that is a footprint that looks like X, but is not X, and X wants to fill that space left behind the Y, when the Y vacates it. I guess what you could say then is that there's a boundary line between them. And so they never combine into each other. They don't interact, because remember, they're at 90 degrees angles difference. They're repelled from each other. So they never interact, and you know, like we talk about, matter and antimatter, they combine and they blow up. No, they don't want to. They're repelled from each other, but they want each other's footprint, which means they're on opposite sides of each other, which is exactly what a yang-yin symbol represents. They're on two different sides of the circle. So each fashions the footprint of it, of its opposite. So the ether alone can't do it. Yet the X and the Y working with ether does. So ether is pretty much forming, taking on a passive role, and merely reacts to the conditions of the X and Y. And that's why we can mimic the existence of X and Y with our electronics and literally manipulate the ether. And this is what Tesla managed to do. And this is what Eric Dollard managed to do. In our small little way, we can fabricate matter, we can fabricate gravitation, and we can manipulate what we fabricate, or dissolve it for that matter, on our small scale, which is what it amounts to by comparison to what happens on the scale, on stellar scale, namely at the core of a stellar body, such as a planet or a star, which amounts to being the same thing, because a Jupiter is, you know, like a pre-star. It's almost big enough to be a star, but it's not quite big enough. So there's really not much difference between a star or a planet. It's just a question of scale. Because the structural functioning of a star or a planet is relativistically the same thing. Our atmosphere and ocean is no different than this photosphere of our sun. Structurally speaking, it's just that there's a phase transition in which the behavior of the oceanic atmosphere of the sun is quite different. It's in a state of plasma. Whereas our ocean and atmosphere is in the state of a liquid and a gas, respectively. So it's very similar, but it's very different, simply because of scale. It's the consequence of a difference in scale. We're small, and the sun is big. and so it has a photosphere, and we don't. Yet one could argue, a case could be made, that matter gives off less photospheric light emission than solid matter, than does a liquid, and hence a liquid less so than a gas. And a gas less than a plasma. So it's all very relative about light emission coming from a photosphere. So we emit light just like our sun does, in the same manner, just not as much. It's very little. So I've covered a lot of things here. Okay, I think that's enough. And of course, the transmutation of matter from one element to another is the mimicry of change in mass based on the analogy of the ice skater who extends her arms and slows down her spin, or withdraws her arms and limbs into herself and spins faster. So by changing her spin, she's able to change the appearance of her mass without actually changing the mass or changing the momentum that's involved with getting her to spin in the first place. And this is somehow involved in the conversion or transmutation of matter from one atomic element into another. Now, it may be quite significant that Mendeleev has stated that X is, or one of the two, one of X, either X or Y, is lighter than the other. They're not the same weight. Either this is compensated for by how the magnetic field behaves versus the electric field, or else it's not compensated by that, and instead creates an inherent imbalance between them, which might be why they swirl in the first place. Because how do you get two objects that are opposite to each other to swirl? You can't. There has to be an imbalance between them. And quite possibly in multiple respective ways, so that ultimately they're balanced, but in terms of details, they're not balanced. They're actually imbalanced. So if we say that, you know, X is hotter than Y and Y is colder than X, well, okay, so maybe Y is bigger than X and X is smaller. So by some other quality that's related to each other, I'm just using temperature and size as examples. But in this case, let's see, usually there's mass versus spin, which is really one and the same. It's two different qualities of the same magnitude, if that makes any sense, because they're easily readily convertible from one into the other quality. So there has to be two sets of qualities, so that with its magnitude versus spin, you have more of one or less of one. So you end up with four qualities. And that makes sense, because in astrology, we have the so-called four elements of water, liquid, solid, solid, liquid, gas, and a plasma. And on a macroscopic scale, those four states of matter may be indicative of those four qualities of greater or lesser spin and greater or lesser magnitude, which may be the only difference between one atomic element and another atomic element. So that's at the most fundamental level in the difference or the distinction between X and Y. But in the most distinct manner, because of they're the most fundamental elements in existence.